My Beauty and Beast True Story. Reptilian First Contact, May 1988, Part 3.
Mira Musa was flying it, and I didn't realize it at the point when I first went into my mind projection inside the ship. I saw the dash, or what I call is a dashboard with these instrument things and stuff like that. And in my mind, I saw this one container that looked like it was full of crystals. And so I'm saying, what's that? And they were saying it's a crystals or something like that to me. And I said, oh. And about that point, I looked up like, who's talking to me? Because I'm still in this, like, I felt like sleep state. And I look up from looking at the instrument panel, I look up and here is this reptilian being, a little bit like Zebrona, but a little heavier. And I thought, who is this? And that's when I heard, this is Mira Musa, I guess that's how it is. But anyway, like I said, I'm trying to put my words to their emotions. And so he was flying the ship. He was actually flying the ship. And now that I'm thinking of it, I think the first thing that I did see in this mind projection was like black with all these stars. And that's it. And then my mind dropped down toward the dash area and was looking at that, questioning that. And then I looked over and saw him, her, you know. Anyway, again, they were trying to get me to understand what it was that they were flying, because I was so curious about it. In fact, they even teased me about being so curious. It's probably one of the reasons I got into the trouble I got into, because, you know, hey, if it can be done, I want to see how it can be done. Or, well, as my dad used to say, you ask more questions, go look it up in the encyclopedia, because that's the way I am. So anyway, let's see, we had apparently two back when I was there on this planet, and we're talking a long, 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 long time ago. I would say maybe a couple of million years ago, give or take, you know. But they said something about the way that they flew then was something to do with nuclear fusion. I don't know what this means. I'm just telling you what words that I was putting to the emotions. So if I ever find a scientist that understands this, maybe we can get into it and I can explain what I was seeing, and maybe they can help me understand what it is that I was seeing and hearing at that time. But like I said, I'm not an engineer, so that part didn't really bother me. I wasn't even curious enough about it to keep on about it. I just wrote down what I was hearing. So he's saying that he hopes our planet becomes more evolved, that he would like to visit us one day without judgment, to embrace us without judgment, but now he felt it was best to stay where he was, which, again, like I said, I agreed. Sorry, I had to read this because it reminds me of a dream, and I'll read the dream too. It says, he chuckled with wisdom and said, they're too inferior to our minds for us to allow that. And I said, that was because I said, these people would just as soon shoot you than talk to you. And he's like, no, they're too inferior to our minds for us to allow that. Hey, Tamari, we control them too much now as it is. Be assured that we do our best to help them, but time will tell. So I'm thinking, mind control, well, yeah, that's what he's teaching me to do. You know, sure. I guess that would be something that they could do around our planet, is keep people from attacking them, so to speak. Anyway, he knew I cared about him. All the energy coming off this being was never, ever, and I want to emphasize this, because I've seen some things come off the internet to say otherwise. This being, and none of the beings that helped me, ever were hateful or ever hurtful to me, ever, even today. In fact, I think that's probably one of the reasons that I'm still here and now to talk to you, because of their protection. Now, Here comes the postscript to my story. In November 1988, I was walking outside my house, the house I was living at the time. I was walking toward my back door, and suddenly I felt as if I was forced, like I just stopped dead and turned around and looked up to the sky. So I felt like this energy was saying, turn around and look now. Nothing was being said. I just felt like I had to turn around and look. And up in the sky was this silver-colored flying saucer. And it was just a silver round. It was round with a little dome on it, something similar to what I'd seen that Zerona was stepping out of when I did my very first mind projection. Here I see this up in the sky, and I'm like, what? And I walk back down the sidewalk looking like I think I'm going to try to get closer, and it's just hovering there. It's not moving. I don't see propellers. I don't see anything that looks like a flying saucer. I'm looking to see if there's any kind of a jet stream. This is a plane that's far, far away, like you normally see a jet stream. Nothing. It just was hovering right there. And shaking my head in disbelief, I turned around and I started walking back to my house, thinking, yeah, it's just, you know, maybe I'm imagining it. And right about that time, my hand hit my doorknob. I heard in my mind, don't worry, Atorian, we told them that you're not ready to leave yet. Now, that should make your heart stop a little bit. So I flipped around real fast to look, and it was gone. That fast. So I start walking back down my sidewalk. I'm looking all up in the sky. Where did it go? What happened to it? And way, way off into the distance, I saw a plane. Now, this one was traveling. It's a normal plane thing with this little energy trail behind it. Nothing like what I had just seen. And I lived by the airport, so I knew what planes looked like. And this is why I said this didn't look anything like a plane or a helicopter or anything. But it was gone. I mean, that fast. And we're talking probably less than, 10 seconds maybe, if long enough to reach up, turn around, and look, and it was gone. And so I walked back in the house, and I was like, well, thank you very much for keeping me here on this planet. But what happened to me is that week that I was on, that day that I was on Murphy in the Morning, the television interview, which I've already uploaded, that whole week was all about, the paranormal type of stuff. And one show was about UFOs. And on this show, this was now in November 1989, I did the television interview, and it was November 1988 that I saw the UFO. And on the show was a mother and a daughter who lived in the next county over. But they were driving along this highway and stopped at a traffic light and looked up, and here was this flying saucer that I saw, and they described it to be exactly like what I saw. And that was a year from the time of this, you know, talk show interview. So it was like telling me, reaffirming to me, yeah, somebody else saw it too, and it wasn't just you. So that just told me that they can be here. How they travel, I don't know, because they haven't given me the privilege of that information. So I will leave it like that. Like I said, this is my Beauty and the Beast story. I mean, a real Beauty and the Beast story. And I don't call them beasts, sorry. No, I don't call myself Beauty either, but this was presented to me about a week ago. They said, why don't you tell your story like Beauty and the Beast? And I said, yeah, that was pretty cool. I can do that. So, anyway, that's my story about mind power, extraterrestrials, UFOs, and like I said, a real Beauty and the Beast story. Or maybe I should say beast, because there was more than one. And I know this is going to sound far-fetched to everyone, but sometimes it takes a little while for us to absorb the information that comes at us. And as my guide told me a long time ago, don't dispute it, just put it aside, and then every now and then look at it and look at it and look at it, and one day you're going to say, oh my goodness, they were right. Have a great year ahead, everyone. Bye-bye now.
Thank you for watching.